talk about virtual open houses for just a second. I put this in my Facebook group. You know, a lot of people are saying, you know, I'm going to go live and I'm going to use my Ricoh camera from Zillow, or I'm going to use my iPhone app from Zillow, or I'm going to whatever it is, and I'm going to go live. And then on Saturday afternoon at 1 o'clock, they press go live and they have their virtual open house. That's great. You might get some people. Here's what I would suggest. And you and I talked about this, and this is a great way of approaching it. You know, on Monday, what they need to do is they need to go, hey guys, on Saturday at 1 o'clock, you know, I'm going to go live. I'm going to have a virtual open house. And Tuesday, they're going to go, hey guys, here's some pictures of the house that I'm going to go live on at 1 o'clock and, you know, share it with somebody else. On Wednesday, they're going to go, by the way, here's a recap of some of the details. You know, it's this many bedrooms and this many bathrooms. Here's the school zone, whatever. Lead up to that. And the best way that I can explain this is it needs to be trailers for a movie. And the movie launch is on Saturday at 1 o'clock, right? That's what we're actually trying to do is to lead people to that and have conversations of, hey, this might not fit for you, but if you've never been to one of these before, if a friend's looking, share it with them. That's a really great way of making sure the people that are there, you know, are going to get the most content from it. Here's whatever you're doing the live, I would keep it short. Hey guys, I'm going to go really quick through this. If there's something you want to see specifically on this house, do me a favor, private message me, and I'll walk through that. I'll walk through that specifically for you, and I'll set it up, you know, either FaceTime or through Facebook so that you can ask me questions and I can point the camera where you need to point the camera. But I'm just not going to do that whenever there's a whole bunch of people watching like this. So what are you doing at that point? You're compartmentalizing people that might be serious about it and getting them to raise their hand and say, Hey, I'd like to look at this a little bit more. I think people can be more effective with their open houses their open house, virtual open houses if they run them that way. Right.
Yeah. I mean, you're the live king when it comes to Facebook Live and stuff like that. So I defer to you on that. In fact, I've never actually done that myself,
right?
Ever. Okay. So yeah, I think you're totally right. I think being concise with everything is definitely the message. And you know, in these times where you're not necessarily getting the showing activity that you would like, and the sellers are maybe a little bit restless, asking what's going on. What a great way for you to show that you still have their best interest in mind. You're still marketing their property. You still care. You are still there. I think that sends the right message to your seller. And that's really what I take away from that. So I think you made some great points there.
Yeah. So what you just said, 100%, we need to talk about this. Actually, we should have talked about this. We should have talked about this first. But, you know, probably the biggest question I've been asked, and I know you've been asked too, is, hey, my sellers are asking what the market's doing right now and whether it's the right time for them to sell or not, yeah. Right? And so, you know, I did this in my Facebook group. I was on another podcast real quick the other day, and I kind of talked about this, and I've heard this a couple of different places. You know, Tom Ferry's talking about this. So everybody's kind of on the same page with this, which I'm really proud of everybody for. But if you haven't heard how to deal with this, this is the best way of dealing with it. Go with the truth. Here's the truth. The truth is we don't know. We're in uncharted territories. So if the seller says, is now the time to sell, you're going to say, you know, I'm not positive what it is that the market is going to do. Why don't we talk about what it is that you're trying to accomplish right now? And then I can help you specifically in your situation determine whether it's the right time to sell or not. Because in the past, what we've done is we've said, here's what the market's doing. That should help you really make a decision of whether now is the time to sell or not. And then speculative sellers and people that needed to sell could both be in the market and get kind of the same result of what they wanted. Right now, that's not the case. There's not as many buyers. There's not as many showings. Loans are still moving. They're not flowing at the pace that they historically have in the past. And I expect that they'll slow down some more, but they're still moving, right? So what we have to do is we have to figure out what the seller's real motivation is. Do they really need to sell? If they really need to sell, absolutely, it's our job to get it on the market. Absolutely, we better be doing virtual open houses. Absolutely, we better be doing everything we can. If they don't really need to sell, then now might not be the time for them, but that's not your decision to make. Your decision to make as an agent is to say, in real life, we don't know what's going on right now with the market. And because we don't, I'm not sure how it's going to be absorbed. Let's get to the bottom of how I can help you.
Yeah, right? That's a good point.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely. I totally agree with that. I mean, I think, sorry, my mailman just walked in.
Yeah.
You know, people, when this happens, you know, tend to fall into that state of fear And I think that in any opportunity, yes, we are in unforeseen times. We have never been here. This is not a foundational recession. This is a completely an outlier type of recession. But where my mind goes when we're in a situation like this is I always look for opportunity. There is opportunity in every type of market. There is an opportunity in every situation. So if you change your mindset to think about opportunity, no matter where you are at, no matter you know, what type of economy we're in, there is opportunity right now. There's going to be opportunity when this whole thing is done. And that's really where my head's at, is that if you start preparing for the future, you know, when those next couple of weeks, when that next quarter comes, when that next year comes, you're already there. Instead of packing your bags right now and just saying, oh, real estate's kaput right now, and, you know, I'm just going to hang out and relax and not think about anything, I promise you, you're going to be behind the times when this thing, you know, winds down.
100%. I think you're exactly right. People have to be moving forward. That starts by having habits right now that are good habits, that are fundamental habits. And this is a good transition for us to talk a little bit about what we touched on in the last podcast, in case anybody missed it. You know, some things this should be an obstacle for, and some things this should be an opportunity for, right? And we talked about habits in both of those. And so how about if I talk about a little bit of opportunity and then you talk about some habits that this should be obstacles for?
Yeah, okay? Definitely.
So opportunity, learning how to work with different tech. You should absolutely be learning how to work with different tech right now. If you've been afraid, now there's never been a better time to screw up in front of your whole sphere of influence on tech than right now. Get out there on the Facebook Lives, or get out there on video, or get out there on, you know, sending out an email by accident to everybody that says, oh shit, I shouldn't send this email out. And all of a sudden it goes out. Now is the best time to do all of those things, because people are going to laugh. They're going to be engaged. They're going to be forgiving. They realize we're going through this together. They've never realized that as much as they do right now, whenever it comes to the real estate industry. I've never seen it like that.
Yeah.
Like how it is right now. So this is your chance to that tech. And then the second thing is, which kind of goes hand in hand with that, is education. If you've been dragging your feet on any kind of education that you wanted to do, now is the time to get out there and do it. If you want to be better with sellers, if you want to understand how to have good conversations with your sellers, now is the time to put all those habits in place that are going to help you have your people look at you a certain way, which is to be an expert, which is to be somebody that cares about them and that knows how to handle a transaction. It's the perfect time to put all that on display.
Handwritten notes too, right? I mean,
Yeah.
I mean, I hear a lot of the excuses during normal markets and during normal real estate business days of, you know, the excuses of why you can't write the handwritten notes, but I promise you, you got the time right now.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. So what should this be an obstacle for? What should this stop people from doing?
I think it should stop people from bad habits. I mean, I think it should stop people from excuses right now. I don't think, I'm not a big excuse person, and you know, the people that I put around me, you know, I ask to call me out whenever I say something that's an excuse. You know, it's my wife, or it's you, or it's my brother, or it's whoever it is in my life. It's like, Justin, that was bullshit, man. Like, retract that. Let's etch a sketch that. Let's get out of here. Because, you know, I think it's really, really important for us to form good habits during this. And I know we talked about it on the last video, but, you know, now is a great, great time to just release a lot of your excuses and kind of start clean. I mean, what do you think about that? What have you done personally, or what are your thoughts on those things?
Yeah. So you're really efficient with your time and stay on point really well with stuff. I've got a lot of things that I just get distracted on. My wife gives me a hard time about all the time, you know, that I'm doing 15 things at once, right? And so this has allowed me to kind of focus in on getting one thing done. And people are a little bit more forgiving, it seems in my mind, if things don't get done as immediately as they possibly can. And so I'll give you a perfect example. So yesterday a broker from Sarasota called and said, hey, I've got an agent that's moving this way. You know, he talked to me. He wants to talk to you. He lives in Clearwater. He might be a good fit for your office. I said, absolutely. I said, listen, I'm right in the middle of like 50 things. You know, how about if I give him a ring tomorrow and catch up with him? He goes, yeah, that's fine. 2 weeks ago, a month ago, I would have never said that.
Right.
That day would not have passed before I would have picked up the phone and somehow reached out to him and said that. So it's allowing me hopefully to get into some different habits of prioritizing things a little bit differently. So that'll help me a tremendous amount. And hopefully everybody out there in podcast land that's going to do the same exact thing for us, it's going to help them kind of reprioritize some things to what really is important compared to, you know, what isn't.
Here's what I hope happens on a, not just an industry level, but on a, let's say a global business platform. For decades upon decades, and let's just say since the Industrial Revolution, expectations have been set on an hourly basis, right? Yep. And I know that this is the millennial coming out at me and saying this, but expectations are in a 8-to-5 work. How much work can you get done in 8-to-5 yep. as opposed to looking at business and looking at productivity on an efficiency metric and right. understanding that, you know, if I can pocket my day and be super, super hyper vigilant and be really, really focused on efficiencies and prioritization, like you're saying, I think you have a better outcome, you have happier employees, and you have a better workplace all around. So I hope that when all of this is done and everyone's safe and we come out of this as a nation, I hope that one of the small lessons that we learn here, and I hope this is just a small one in the grand scheme of things, is that we prioritize efficiency over hard work or length of duration activity. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, you know, anybody, you know, a hamster can be busy on a hamster wheel, but that doesn't, being busy doesn't mean that you're being productive for your company or making money or doing the right thing.
Right. And like a washing machine, right? It works really hard, but it doesn't get anywhere.
Yeah. But I just, you know, that's kind of my glimmer of hope. That's always been a little pet peeve of mine because I know how my mind works and you work the same way. You know, I work better when I have that creative flow and I'm able yeah. to kind of, you know, flush that out my way as opposed to here's what you got, you know, go get them. Yeah. That said, it's a really good time for us to kind of get out of our comfort zone and start learning some different things. Just as like a parting note, I think that vulnerability is often looked at as a weakness. And I think that vulnerability needs to be looked at as a strength. And I think that the people who are vulnerable and let themselves be vulnerable are the people who are open to growth and have that growth mindset. And so now more than ever, I encourage you to be vulnerable. I encourage you to be really honest with yourself and saying, yeah, maybe I need to brush up on this education bit here, or maybe I should get into a little bit of social media here. Just be vulnerable. I mean, what's the worst that happens? You fall flat on your face and you just got to get back up again. Not a big deal. Matt and I do it every day. We're certainly not perfect at it. You know, this is a perfect example of Matt and I doing that as we speak. This is something that if you asked us 2 years ago, we would probably tell you, hell no.
But I can't even begin to tell you how much hell no there is in it.
Yeah, but vulnerability is good. Vulnerability is really, really good for growth. So if you're looking to become a better person, if you're looking to have a better version of yourself, and vulnerability could be exercise related, diet related. Vulnerability is everything. So let yourself be vulnerable. Get better. This is a great time to form those habits. And I think it starts with vulnerability.
Great, great point, Justin. Absolutely fantastic point.
So always cool. Like, comment, subscribe, ask us questions. We are here to help. We're a community. We sincerely appreciate you. Let's stick as a community. How can we help each other? Love you guys.
Peace.